He was born in Moscow and was a hereditary Russian nobleman. However, he spent over 20 years in Ukraine, where he tried to implement his humanistic and educational ideas, aimed at formation of Ukrainian intelligentsia, science, and education. Thanks to his civic activity in Kyiv, for the first time in the Russian Empire, a secondary Sunday school was opened in 1859. As a world-famous surgeon, he could have lived and worked in France or Germany, but he chose Ukraine. Nikolay Pirogov was one of the people who were literally obsessed with their profession. He was the first to create the Human Clinical Anatomy Atlas, became the founder of military field surgery, and initiated the use of anesthesia during surgical interventions. He remains the number one physician for both Russia and Ukraine, not just because he enriched world surgery with talented fundamental discoveries. First and foremost, he received the title of number one physician for his spiritual purity, courage in disputes, courage in battle, and honesty in science and life. He spent 27 years living in Ukraine, including the turbulent years associated with the Crimean War. After settling in his estate in Vyshnya in the territory of modern Vinnytsia region, he spent the rest of his life there. He got his final rest there. Nikolay Pirogov was one of the most important personalities of the 19th century. His name was associated with everything that happened in the Russian Empire, with medical science and education. Pirogov's father was a military man. But there were a lot of physicians among the family's friends. The boy eagerly listened to their interesting stories of medical practice. For a long while, he could not decide whether to be a soldier or a physician. Nikolai was a capable child. When he was 14, he graduated from a private boarding school and decided to join the medical faculty. They made an exception for the gifted young man, and he became a student at the Moscow University at the age of 14 instead of 16, as was required by the rules. At the time, he studied and worked in the anatomical theater, where he gained invaluable experience in practical surgery. After receiving his diploma, he spent several more years studying abroad. Back in the day, he also graduated from a postgraduate school in Darmstadt, after which he was trained and acquired surgical skills in Berlin. They already knew him when he arrived there. The thing was that he prepared a unique monograph on the abdominal aorta. So when he arrived there, he suddenly discovered that prominent surgeons, prominent physicians in Germany, had been reading his work and knew him well. There he adopted advanced European practices. After he returned home successful and accomplished, he was the only one awarded the prestigious Demidov Prize of 5,000 rubles. After returning to Russia, he was offered to head the Department of Surgery at the Surgical Academy of St. Petersburg. And soon after, Pirogov opened the first surgical hospital with a 1,000-bed capacity. Not long after, he conducted the first successful surgery with the use of etheric anesthesia, which became a powerful breakthrough in the world of medical science. The narcosis mask design that Pirogov developed back then is still being used in medicine. In 1847, Nikolay Pirogov went to the Caucasus War in order to test scientific developments in field conditions. There he carried out thousands of surgeries using anesthesia and applied the starch-impregnated bandages he invented, which became the prototype of a modern plaster bandage. In the autumn of 1854, Pirogov went to the Crimean War with a group of doctors and nurses, where he became the chief surgeon in Sevastopol. Obviously, he had a kind soul. He was very sympathetic, so he went to that horrible war. The Crimean War is sometimes depicted as a parade picture, but it was actually hell. And when he saw the lack of control of the royal administration and boundless embezzlement, he started writing letters to all administrative bodies. He demanded an audience and eventually received an audience from the king. Alexander II initially accepted everything that was proposed by Pirogov. Those were the issues of medicine, the reformation of medicine. He liked that, especially since it was a time of war. The Russian Empire had been taking part in several wars, so medical care during military operations had to have the highest priority. Pirogov was the first to mention that. Alexander II liked his ideas and agreed with them at first. But later, there was a conflict between Alexander II and Pirogov. When the king asked him if all the officials there were indeed stealing, he replied with, "Yes, all of them are thieves of the highest grade." The king lost his temper and shouted, "Either you stop talking like that, or you will be arrested right now," threw his papers and left the office. And that's how his audience with the king went. After the audience with the Russian emperor, Pirogov fell out of favor at the court for his audacity and frankness and was appointed trustee of the Odessa Educational District. At the time, it included the territory of modern Zaporizhia, parts of the Dnepropetrovsk Oblast and the adjoining regions of Crimea. With bad roads, and he did there what no one else did. In 1857, in just 1 year, he'd traveled everywhere in the district, even to remote schools, talked with teachers, and worked on probably the biggest achievement of modern Odessa, the creation of a university based on Richelieu Lyceum. He wrote several letters to Alexander II about opening higher educational institutions not only on the territory of Ukraine, on Ukrainian lands, but throughout the Russian Empire as a whole. Alexander gave an interesting answer to that. This doctor wants to open more universities than there are taverns in the Russian Empire. As an honest and frank man, in his public speeches, Pirogov stressed that the existing education system in Russia was backward and conservative. He emphasized that the national idea of any civilized state should be the idea of bringing up and educating the younger generation by modern methods. These views brought him popularity among students and young teachers and great hatred among officials.
Врешті-решт закінчилось тим, що він був переведений із Одеси, з Одеського округа у Київський. Його оцім
In the end, he was transferred from Odessa, from the Odessa district to Kyiv. A lot of undertakings are connected with his being there as a mentor, curator and trustee of the Kyiv educational district. When he arrived there, he saw a terrible mismatch with the needs of public education. For example, at the time, out of 200 residents, only one was a student. If the state spent 900 rubles on the upbringing and education of the noble family representatives, the spending on a peasant's son was 4 kopecks. He rebelled against that.
На селянського сина витрачали 4 копійки. Він повстав проти цього.
Pirogov fought for the availability of education for the people. It was with his assistance as a trustee of the Kyiv Educational District that for the first time in the Russian Empire, free Sunday schools for children of workers, craftsmen, and people without a profession began to open. Teachers were mostly students of Kyiv University, who would later become famous scientists, writers, and public figures. Among them, there are the Ukrainian playwright Mykhailo Staritsky, journalist, historian, and folklorist Mykhailo Drahomanov, writer, author of the textbook for Sunday schools Anatoly Svidnitsky, well-known physicist Veniamin Portuhalov, and many others. Taras Shevchenko showed interest in the activities of Sunday schools. Just for them, the poet wrote and published the South Russian alphabet book at his own expense. The paradox is that when he arrived in Ukraine, he started defending the Ukrainian language. A seemingly innocent and useful activity of Sunday schools created by Nikolay Pirogov concealed a profound meaning in itself. Democratic ideas that reveal the essence of autocracy and national oppression systems were propagated there. It is clear that many officials, especially the Kyiv Governor General, did not like Pirogov's activities. And the General Governor Васильчиков simply could not understand Pirogov and his program. He blamed him, which scared the king a lot, of having Jacobin sentiments, supporting the French Revolution, of being a progressivist. And he expressed the following opinion. The text of Pirogov's negative characteristic was preserved. In it, he said that instead of morally sound and skilled teachers, faithful teachers should be invited. The king wrote, "I completely agree," beside that sentence. That ended with Pirogov's resignation, which was also sanctioned by Alexander II.
Врешті-решт це закінчилося відставкою Пірогова, причому її теж санкціонував Олександр II.
Pirogov was dismissed from his position for being totally unable to manage education. Unlike the official authorities, the community of Kyiv, the student community, organized two scientific and educational feasts devoted to the work of Pirogov.
Причому вперше в Російській імперії надходили співчутливі телеграми.
For the first time in the Russian Empire, sympathetic telegrams were sent. And Herzen, the leader of the foreign emigration in London, wrote in Kolokol that the resignation of Pirogov was the most shameless, most dismaying matter. It was well put and mentioned Russian fools. That way he emphasized that he distinguished Ukraine and Russia.
І Україну, і Росію таким чином.
After the resignation, Pirogov was granted a lifelong retirement pension, which was soon abolished. He repeatedly traveled abroad, where he participated in scientific conferences and seminars. During one of his trips, he was asked to provide medical assistance to the wounded leader of the Italian National Liberation Movement, Giuseppe Garibaldi. His leg was seriously wounded. Amputation was a very likely solution. Only thanks to the intervention of Pirogov, his leg was saved. After 26 days, he got back on his feet and then completely recovered. He was infinitely thankful to Pirogov. In 1866, Nikolay Pirogov settled in his estate in Vishnya, in the Vinnytsia province, where he opened a free clinic and continued his medical practice. The sick and the suffering came to the miraculous doctor from all corners of the Russian Empire.
Коли він жив у Вишні, там розповідають, що він нерозмірений, спеціально таке.
There are stories of when he lived in Vishnya, that he led a special kind of moderate lifestyle, just like when he lived in St. Petersburg, working every waking moment. He got up very early. They say he used to have a long walk. Then he had a very simple one-meal breakfast. Then he had some strong coffee and went to work. It is said that he devoted 2 days a week to charity medical aid. After the surgery, he put his hands in his pockets so nobody could give him money. His legacy was so great that he was remembered for decades.
Зберіг пам'ять про себе просто настільки добру, що вона тривала десятиліття.
Nikolay Pirogov passed away in 1881. With the permission of his wife and the Orthodox Church, the surgeon students embalmed his body. The Pirogov farmstead exists to this day. It is now the museum of the great scientist. Pirogov readings, devoted to the contribution of the surgeon to world medicine and international medical conferences, are held here annually. Nikolay Pirogov became part of our national history both as a talented medical innovator and as a classic of the original advanced pedagogical thought, a noble and deeply humane person.